Hey, welcome to Bishop Justice. Another week. Hey, we thank you for your phone calls. One phone call in particular, though, I don't know if I should have took the advice. You know, I've been having problems with the pollen, my allergies. So I went to the drugstore and got the pills that the person called me and said, Bishop, take this. I took two of them and I woke up the next day. But it worked. It cleared up my allergies, I guess, because I didn't have to worry about it till the next day. What we have, I promised somebody I would do something. You know, Bishop always keeps his word. Mom's Cookies. Like to say hello to Lou Boone and Maggie Douglas. They're at 2569 and a half Central Avenue. Hey, I go get those chocolate chip cookies with pecan in there for my wife. She loves them. Matter of fact, my wife says I need to stop bringing them to her. Another thing is, I did a segment on my international radio show yesterday, so I got to keep true to my word. And we were talking about forgiveness. So out there, ever in my 48 years, going 49 years on this planet, I've ever wronged anybody, forgive me. If you ever wrong me, you have my forgiveness. So the thing about it is, you can't ask God to forgive you if you can't forgive others. Don't look for a blessing in God if you can't do the right thing. So with that, also, if you got a political commercial, I have a lot of people calling me about these commercials. We can't do anything till May 25th after the qualifying period. And then I'll be more than happy to help you with your ads, with your political ads. That don't stop you from doing your regular business ads, anything like that. We still can do that. So give me a call at any time and we'll come make your on spot, make your commercial, whatever ads. But again, political ads can't do anything till after May 25th. A good thing, two of my past guests are the top fundraisers, top money receiving. Sheriff, I already made him sheriff. Captain Scott Peebles is leading the fundraising race, and R.W. Allen, both previous guests on this show, have raised the most amount of money to date, and we continue to wish them luck. With that said, I think I got everybody. I think I got everybody away. Bible scripture for today is get along with each other and forgive each other. If someone does wrong to you, forgive that person because the Lord forgave you. That's Colossians 3:13. So you know we can't start our show without the Bible verse and giving our announcement. So I think I got everybody. Hey, with that said, my next guest, very, very, very special person. I've seen him a long time. We really not have talked that much like that, but I've seen him. I see him in the business world. Every time I've seen him, he's been very, very nice, very, very cordial. An absolute gentleman, man of God. I mean, just impeccable character. He's the type of person, if he can't help you, he sure won't hurt you. But with that said, we have attorney Victor Hawk here as my very, very special guest today. Mr. Hawk.
Very good to be here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. I know we were going back and forth trying to get each other.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, we're here.
That's right. That's right.
We're here.
And so I appreciate you inviting me.
I thank you because, a lot of times, I like to confirm, I guess, like a week out, just to get to work on some things and get my questions together, things like that. But I know as an attorney, you get calls probably from down, at any time. Somebody calling from down to 401 or whatever, say, hey, I need some help or whatever.
That's right.
So you're not going to turn down the money or the business opportunity.
Right.
And especially in your field, that phone call is so important because you got to go down there as a potential client. But we'll get into that in a minute. But as always, I like to know, who is Victor Hawk?
Yeah. Vic Hawk is a guy that's born and raised around here. The vast majority of those people that advertise on TV are just absentee lawyers. Right. They're just lawyers that set up businesses and pay a bunch of money for advertising, and a lot of times they really hurt the profession.
Right.
Because those persons that are really in need get hurt because the perception of the public created by those advertisements is a negative one.
Right.
When the person in need that suffered some kind of injury or had some unusual circumstance happen in their life is faced with that circumstance, it's not a reward. It's not a pot of gold. It's not some prize they won. It's a tragedy that they're experiencing, and the question is how you can help put them back to where they were prior to the tragic event occurring. And Vic Hawk is born and raised, like I said, around here. I went to Butler High School, graduated from Butler High School. Went off to the University of Georgia, studied political science, got married, had a little one, got accepted to law school. I got on a waiting list at Georgia, a waiting list at Mercer, and I got accepted in Alabama. They gave me 3 days to accept my seat. I said, I'm on my way. And took my seat, and once I got there, I loved it. It was a great trial school, really prepared you to be a trial lawyer.
So Mercer was your first choice, though?
Do what now?
Mercer University was your first
Well,
choice?
I applied at Mercer in Georgia and Samford University in Alabama. There are a number of lawyers and judges here in this community that graduated from Samford University, Judge Jim Blanchard, Judge Bill Jennings. There are a number of trial lawyers in the community that have graduated from Samford University. It's a great trial school. They have a courtroom for us our senior year, and they train you. Probably the best training I've had in a courtroom was there in law school, because we had circuit judges, similar to Superior Court judges here, teaching us. And they would video us, and the judges would yell at us and point out what we didn't know, and it encouraged us to get better. And so I thought that was a great experience. And it was a tough experience. You know, when I went to law school, we had a table, two chairs, and a mattress, and our clothes, and that was it. And then we found an apartment, and the people there in Alabama were great to us. They gave us, you know, furniture they didn't want, or they were buying new furniture or whatever. And we were on our feet within a matter of 3 or 4 months, and I was off and
Sanford,
progressing toward the law degree.
I have one of my high school coaches went to Sanford, so I know it's a good school. I was going to go to actually. Mercer accepted me on a tennis scholarship.
Right.
But if you read my high school yearbook, it says attorney.
Mm-hmm.
And who's who? It says attorney.
That's what you were going
to
be.
That's what I want. Yeah. But what happened was, I wound up going to school to be a biochemist. Because I thought, I didn't know what to major in to be an attorney, because I figured I could do it so well.
Yeah.
Because we had a little course in my high school where we had an excellent teacher. It taught me the things I know about, you know, politics to this day.
Sure.
But I won all the debates. I won all the attorney contests, all the legal contests. I won every one of them. I had an A+. I had 100. Yeah. So I thought it was too easy. So I said, that's not going to be a challenge for me. So I wound up going to school to major in biology, you know, minor in chemistry.
Yeah.
And so maybe that might have been too tough for me. But
my first chemistry course got me out of wanting to be a doctor.
P-chem, but it was probably like me, it was physical chemistry, and it was kind of tough.
Yeah.
But you know, in the legal profession here in Augusta, Georgia, it's a situation where you got what they call good attorneys, then you got middle-of-the-road attorneys, and you got bad attorneys.
Right.
Victor Hawk has always said he's a good attorney.
Right.
If you call, it's known in this community, they call you, they're coming. It's really not about you're asking over the phone how much money you got.
Right.
Because, you know, that's the thing that really kind of bothers me a lot. You call an attorney and then we're discussing fees.
Right.
You know, before you even know, you know, can you come down here and talk to me? Can you help me out?
Right.
We'll get to the money later. Yeah. But I've always heard that when people call, you come.
Yeah.
And then you always discuss about the money later. That is something good to have, because my thing is, if the quantity is there, you see, if people, you have that reputation that they know,
right,
the money's going to come.
Right.
People know your reputation, and the money's going to come. But a lot of young attorneys nowadays, they don't get that. They want to snatch and get the money now.
Right.
But what is your take on the legal profession in Augusta now? How's it when you first started out and fast forward to now?
Right.
How's it shifted?
It's much more diverse, both racially and sexually.
Mm-hmm.
When I went to law school, they
sexually,
were,
you mean y'all having more sex?
No. I mean, there used to be, when I graduated from law school, there were 3 girls in my class.
Okay, I got you.
And I went back and took a national board certification in Birmingham. 2 years ago, and I visited my law school, and 72% of the graduating class were women.
Well, our district attorney
is
a female.
So that's right. And so that's a huge change in the legal community, the number of women involved. Also, of course, the African-American percentages have gone up, but it's men and women.
Right.
So it's much more diverse. When I first started practice or tried to start practice, unless you were members of certain families or knew certain people in the in the legal profession, it was difficult to get a job and it was difficult to get work. Mm-hmm. I was the first one to graduate from college in any direction of my family, mm-hmm. and so you know, all my friends and in the community were working class people.
That's right.
You know,
right.
And so I've found that the bar is very open now. The bar is much more able to handle the general population's needs than they were before. I think a lot of the good young lawyers mm-hmm. Care about their people. I make a good living. I've been very fortunate, but I make a good living because we take care of our people.
That's right.
You know, we want to win every single case that mm-hmm. that we work on. And if we can't win, we want at least a good result
right.
for the person.
Right.
And I've found if you care about the people you're trying to help, mm-hmm. you're going to get rewarded for your work. And that's just the way it's been for me.
Right.
I did criminal work until 87, and then I had three cases. I got not guilty, not guilty, dismissed,
right.
and the people went out and committed worse crimes. And it really hurt me to the core that happened, because
right.
those were three new victims.
Right.
And so I turned over all my criminal practice to my brother,
mm-hmm.
And I stopped practicing criminal work for 5 years. But then I started noticing that people were being convicted of things they shouldn't be convicted of.
That's right.
And I started seeing, lawyers coming in to try cases, and they got a little piece of paper, a little file like that,
mm-hmm.
and they're trying a major felony.
Right.
You can't protect someone unless you prepare.
Right.
Whether it be protect them on the sentencing side to get the best result possible, or to protect them to help them to be found
right.
not guilty.
Right.
And so I gradually started getting back involved. And of course now, I don't know if you've noticed it, but we don't really advertise for criminal work at all.
Mm-hmm.
But the people in the community know that we care about our people.
Right.
They know that we're going to do the good work. And it just flows through the door.
I noticed that.
And we have been trying to increase the personal injury side of the practice, because we see so many members of the community going to these advertising lawyers and their cases being wholesaled.
Right.
You know, they might advertise that, well, I settle a case for $100,000, I settle a case for $300,000. Well, that's great. But if the case should have been paid $300,000 instead of $100,000,
right.
that's not good.
Right.
If the case was worth $10,000 and they settled it for $1,200, that's not good.
Right.
The only legal malpractice claim I've ever filed is against one of those lawyers, where that lawyer took the case, settled the claim without the permission of the clients,
mm-hmm.
and signed the back of the check, and then just sent them a check saying, hey, this is all you could get, and that's all there was to it.
Hmm.
And he paid a high price for doing that. I mean, a high price. He didn't get disbarred. He later got put in federal prison for something totally unrelated. But, you know, he was one of the biggest advertisers in this community.
Right.
Had actors
right.
advertising
right.
for him. And that, I want to do more personal injury work to help the members of the public who I think are just being raked over the coals
right.
with regard to the representation. And we, you know, we do a law program called Law Call on Sunday night, and I bring in real
right.
lawyers who do
right.
real work
right.
and help people.
Right.
And the whole purpose behind that is to help give the public a better understanding as to who they should go to in the event they need help. Like, say, for example, if they're badly injured in a wreck, or badly injured on the job, or badly
mm-hmm.
injured under some other unfortunate circumstance that isn't their fault. we tell them, go talk to the lawyer. Mm-hmm. Ask them if they've ever tried a case in court. Mm-hmm. Have they tried a case in the last 2 years?
Right.
What was the result of those cases? Are they members of any trial associations? Right. Have they attended any trial schools? Do they have any recognition for their merit as a trial lawyer? Right. What kind of verdicts have they received in the last 4 or 5 years? Mm-hmm. And if a lawyer tells you, and one of these advertising lawyers that we see that's
national.
That, yeah, mm-hmm. Well, that these
well,
national
the 1-800
commercials.
Number.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah. You know, he hadn't tried a case higher than magistrate court, and that was 15 years ago.
Mm.
Magistrate court.
Yeah.
That's people's court.
Yeah.
And this and people are entrusting.
Traffic tickets.
Yeah, people are entrusting their lives and their well-being and their future to those kinds of persons, and and that's, you know, that's why I've been really pushing to do more personal injury work, because there's a real need there, and it's wrong. What's happening to the public is wrong. If you're in that type of tragic circumstance, you should not be shackled with a lawyer that can't go to court for you, with a lawyer who's wholesaling the cases, with a lawyer that's got a special a person assigned with each insurance company just to settle their cases once a month.
Right.
You know, because they're wholesaling it.
Right.
I mean, they're Sam's wholesaling it.
Right.
You know, other people's lives, and I think that's a terrible thing. What? So if you ask those questions when you go see a lawyer and they can't give you good answers, you need to choose another one.
So
and there's some good trial lawyers in this community.
They need to do the homework, really.
Absolutely. You don't entrust your family's welfare to someone that you haven't checked out.
You know, what is the, is there a case that you won't take? You know, I'm just saying, not this, the way I've said it, but I'm talking about ethically and morally. If there's something, somebody calls you and says something is involved.
Sure.
Is there something, the kind of case that you just won't take?
Yeah. There are a number of them. Pretty much absolutely refuse to take death penalty cases. And the reason for it is that I'm a real emotional kind of guy.
Yeah.
I really care about people. And in most cases where the death penalty is involved, there are extremely egregious circumstances. And, and I think they need someone who can step aside, set their emotions aside to defend that person and really do a good job. I rarely, if ever, take a child abuse case. When I have taken them, there have been circumstances where after I looked into it, I was very confident that this was overcharged. Say, for example, a parent spanking a child.
Right.
All right. You can spank a child, and that child could have bruises, scratches, whatever. But that child may be the kind of child
that need
that whooping, you know, and somebody has overreacted in putting such a serious charge. I represented a police officer one time in a case like that, and he was trying to help this child to understand that she had to respect authority, behave in school, follow her teacher's instructions, and do her homework at home, and this child was very difficult, and he really saved the child. But anyway, the charges were dismissed. And I'll tell you one other one would be where if anybody tells me they committed the crime and then they want me to say that they didn't, or they say, well, I got these witnesses to say I wasn't there, but I really was, I wouldn't do that. Just, you know, it's unethical, and you get disbarred for it. If lawyers do it, then, you know, they should be disbarred.
Many years ago, this has been my third time on TV. I had an attorney on here before, and now he's a judge in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. But you have any political aspirations that you would think of later on or run across your mind?
The answer is no.
Okay.
And the reason for it is this. I think I can do more good where I am.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I think that there's a real need for good trial lawyers who look out for their people, do the work they say they're going to do, and they do the best that they can.
Right.
I think there's a real need for that in the community. And it's good mentoring for the younger lawyers coming up. In other words, it's not okay to show up half prepared.
Right.
You know, it's not okay to not have your witnesses there. Right. It's not okay to not care about the people that you're standing up for.
Right.
You know, if I played another role in the community, I think that it would take away from that.
Yeah.
I mean,
but it's
I enjoy doing what I'm doing. I enjoy helping the people I'm able to help. And sometimes the public may not understand why I take certain cases.
Right.
But if they ever sat in on the trial, they would.
What's the flexibility that you have? Because getting involved with politics, I don't want to mention any other attorneys' names. I have several friends of mine.
Right.
I'd be disrespectful to you to mention anybody else. But I have several friends that I grew up with and attorneys that, that dabbled into politics because I got into politics at a very, very young age.
Yeah.
But politics is a dirty game.
Yeah.
And back in the day, it was nothing but attorneys in Congress, you know, state reps.
Yeah.
But nowadays, it's not that way anymore. The Congress, politics is so diversified now that it's not just attorneys, you know.
In the legislature,
making the laws.
That's right.
So I think a lot of times, like you said, you have the flexibility. Probably don't want to deal with the drama and the nonsense.
Right.
But
I don't really play the political game.
Right.
I mean, you know, if he's a good person, he's a good person.
Right.
And you know, that's what we all strive for. Is that, you know, as Dr. King said, you know, when we have reached our goal is when we can look at a person and not decide who that person is based on their race, color, sex, creed, or national origin. But the character of the person that's there in front of you.
The content, okay, yeah. So, you know, that's, you know, my dad came down here from 1978 from the Pentagon.
Uh-huh.
Things then were really kind of rough in Richmond County.
Yeah.
I'm talking about racially.
Mm-hmm.
But Augusta has come a long, long way as far as race.
Mm-hmm.
Because the things that have changed the most, I see more interaction between blacks and whites.
Right.
And it wasn't always like that when I came here in 1978. In 1978, me and you couldn't have this conversation. We wouldn't be sitting here. I wouldn't be hosting the show, and you wouldn't be sitting, you know, over there.
Well, if you were hosting the show, we wouldn't be having the conversation because I just have real strong feelings about that.
But
you are who you are,
yeah.
And I respect you for being who you are.
You've always been I've always heard, you know, nothing but good, positive things about you, about your law firm. I watched a good friend of mine, he hosts, you got a program on there that y'all do. Tell me a little bit about that. Neil Gordon's a good friend of mine.
Oh, yeah,
he's one
Law
of your
Call. Yeah, that's what I was talking about earlier. Yeah, we do it on Sunday nights.
Okay.
After the news at 11:30, it's about the only period of time I can afford. It's expensive enough as it is.
Okay.
And we bring on lawyers in the community that I know are good lawyers.
Right.
And we answer questions from the public, but most importantly, we have a theme every week.
Mm-hmm.
So that if we're talking about bankruptcy, like we had bankruptcy this last Sunday night, we tell them something about bankruptcy that will help the public to understand more about bankruptcy and when they should consider it. Like we told them this last time, you should consider it when you're using your credit card to pay for your groceries.
Mm-hmm.
If you're using your credit card to pay for your gas bill, your electric bill, you know, you've really gotten over your head and you're creating more and more debt.
Right.
How soon should you go to a lawyer? You should go immediately because now under the bankruptcy rules, before you can file bankruptcy, you have to go through this creditor's program, a debtor's program to teach you how to manage your affairs. If there's a foreclosure pending, you need to be able to stop that foreclosure. And if you go to a lawyer quickly, then it's much easier to stop it than if you go at the last second. And for reasons like that. And we answered various questions from the public. And I tell you the surprising thing about it.
Mm-hmm.
We get bumped sometimes by something like when Bin Laden was killed, March Madness, the Grammys. We get moved into later in the night.
Mm-hmm.
And we started the show as late as 12:20 at night.
Ooh.
And phone lines fill up.
Right.
People still up on Sunday. I'm sitting there saying, you know, thank God for you, but gee whiz, I don't know how y'all can do it. And the viewership has actually doubled in a year So the station's real happy with it, and I'm happy with it. I'm happy to do it for everyone.
I watch it. Like I said, I think you used a good friend of mine, Neil Gordon.
Yeah.
And it's a very, what we call it, educating show. I don't like to watch something if I can't learn something from what you're saying.
Right.
I noticed something else, too, in the community with these, the crime is, is increasing. Mm-hmm. So is your caseload is increasing because with all this crime going on, they need attorneys?
Our practice is doing very well. And the problem with the crime increasing has some relationship to the economy.
Right.
As a practical matter, you can be in the situation of just being totally destitute, and as a result, either they fall off the wagon and go into drugs, and which in turn requires money, and they don't have money, and then they start stealing, and then you have violent crimes that are related to the drug.
Where can we find you at?
You can find me at 338 Telfair. We also have an office in Evans and Thompson and in Waynesboro. You can call me on my cell phone, 294-4447. You can call the office at 722-3500. Our office lines are answered 24/7.
Right.
So if you call the office and you don't get a call back, you call me on my cell phone because I'm going to find out why.
I know you will. Thank you.
Very nice.
Thank
to
you,
meet
Mr.
you.
Hall.
Thank you for having me.
I'm glad you took time out your schedule. I'm glad I made it through it with this pollen tearing me up. And I might need to go home and take two more of those pills that one of my guests recommended me to take, and I won't wake up till tomorrow.
That's right. That'll be good for you, though.
With that said, we'd like to thank you for tuning in to Bishop Dresses again. We just had multiple phone calls, letters, and I'd like to thank you for that. I just got a call from Bahamas. I did pray for you and your family. Again, thank you for watching. Say hello to my grandkids, my wife, all my church members out there, All Saints Christian Church. Look me up on Facebook, Bishop Justice Wilson. Friend me. I will friend you back. With that said, take care. We'll see you next time. God bless you.
There's no question of your greatness, no searching of your power. Oh, the wonder of your glory, to you 40 years is but 1 hour. Your knowledge is all-encompassing, to your wisdom there is no end. Oh, for you alone are God. You are God alone. Your mercy is everlasting. Your truth is here always. You are He who was and is to come. Who is He that can number your days? You flung the sun to burn in space, and the night's moon borrows light from day. Oh, you alone. Your God, Elohim, you're everything I need. You are God alone. Now unto the King, eternal.